Well, we first spoke with our next guest a few months ago about her life as a movie stuntwoman. But Ky Furneaux is also an expert on finding food in the wild. She's a survivalist, so we thought we'd get some expert tips from her before anyone takes off on Christmas holidays. Welcome back to the show,
Ky. Thank you so much.
Geez, you wouldn't want to get too lost in Noosa, would you?
No. Well, if you do, we do have some wild foods available in Noosa as well.
Tell us, how did you become an expert on survival?
I was an outdoor guide before I became a stunt performer, yeah. And I was just always fascinated in sort of the going harder and more extreme. I think that's part of my personality.
Because you did that show Naked and Afraid, didn't you?
Did.
Where they drop you naked in the wilderness and you've got to survive.
Yeah, so...
Naked? Why naked?
Well, because you're naked and afraid.
They're taking away the last of the protective element that you have around you.
So what did you do
when
you were naked? The first thing you did
this.
Make something to put on?
No, because they dumped us like waist deep in alligator infested water. So the last thing I was thinking of is, oh my gosh, my breasts are out. You know, I was not thinking about that at all. I was thinking, am I going to survive this experience and where are the alligators? So there's just more important things going on at the time than whether or not you have clothes on.
Okay, starting with the pine nuts.
So, a lot of people, this has come to my attention, a lot of people are getting lost out there, and a lot of these plants are everywhere in the world. So the most important one, I think, is the pine tree. So you can actually eat the nuts from the pine tree when they're in season. You can make a tea out of the pine needles, which is really good for coughs and colds and is high in vitamin
really?
C. Yeah, so if you're out there in the bush and you start feeling a bit sick, you can make a tea out of it. Just going to give it a go.
Give it a taste. Is that nice?
Oh, gosh, you can really taste the pine needles.
feeling better already.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you can also eat the inner bark. So the thing is to get some sort of sustenance and some solid foods out there. So the inner bark is high in fibre, of course, because it's bark, and it's also high in vitamin A and vitamin C. So this is a nice one. I've roasted this up with a little bit of salt, if you'd like to have a taste of this.
That's bark.
That's bark. Can taste a little bit piney to begin with, but then, you know, when you get the taste of it, it's not so bad. You can eat it raw.
Do you have to be careful what type of bark you eat from a tree, that you're not eating something poisonous that might kill you?
Here, I got a napkin just in case you'd like to spit that out. It can have a strong pine taste, depending on... You've got to remember, you're in a survival situation here. This is not something that you would choose to eat on a daily basis.
So what about these? I remember being told that these were called wet the beds, and if you smelt them, you'd wet the bed that night. So
absolutely
I'd avoid these
not.
As a kid.
I think that was the school kids playing a prank on
you. I think so, but you're allowed to eat these?
Yeah, you can eat the flower heads, and you can also eat the leaves. The roots are really great if you make up a tea. It's good for liver and detox. So you'll find these in actual health food stores
Dandelion tea.
Yeah,
I've seen that.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's just this little plant here. You can find it everywhere out there. There are some false dandelions. So what you're looking for is a single stem flower like this. The false dandelions tend to be in clusters. And you can eat the flowers too. So you can just sort of shove them on a salad and bite the heads off, and they're actually quite sweet.
Right.
I want to know what this is because...
They're pine needles.
Oh, they're the pine needles.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You can make your tea out of that.
Yeah.
What about this seaweed stuff?
Right, so there's no toxic seaweeds in the world.
Oh, really?
No.
Okay.
So if you're lost on a deserted island and seaweed's washing up, again, it's not amazingly palatable most of the time. You do get lucky, you get some good ones and you get some bad ones.
It's very fishy.
It is very fishy.
Yeah, it's very
comes
fishy.
From the sea.
Yes. Do you have to dry it first?
You can eat it raw, straight out of the sea, or you can dry it.
Say you've got no water, you can't have salty stuff. It makes it worse.
Right, but if you do happen to be by the ocean, this is a coastal succulent, and this is actually full of water.
Pig's face.
It is pig's face. And people have no idea. Look, you might like this one. Tastes a little bit salty to begin with, but then it tastes a bit like cucumber. We'll go for you. So you get a snap of salt and then it's quite crispy. So that can actually give you moisture. Just wait till we get to the crickets.
So you've got crickets and worms as well that we're able to
that
eat.
That looks like what I think the meerkats.
Absolutely.
Meerkats eat that.
Yeah.
They?
And so these are really high protein, aren't they?
These are food grade mealworms and crickets supplied by Grillo Protein from Byron Bay. They make amazing protein power and protein bars out of these things. So they've prepared these especially.
But you could, if you were lost in the bush though, you'd have to be careful about what bugs you start gnawing on.
You know, I avoid spiders and anything that's eating rotten meat.
But anything that can eat you, don't eat them.
Right.
Okay.
Well, and then, but if you find bugs that are eating wood, then you're good to go. Like, cook them up a little bit. Yeah. And there's
So you have to cook them, though? You can't eat them raw?
You know, you can eat them raw, but if you're going to make them a little bit more palatable, you want
to... Make them crunchy.
you want to cook them up. But over 2 billion people in the world at this moment in time include insects in their diet as part of their regular dietary intake. Right.
Now, I've read that if you are in the wilderness or you're lost, you can survive for up to a month without food, but water is crucial. You can only survive a few days without water.
And especially in Australia, you can only survive up to 1 day in Australia.
Is that right?
In the bush.
Yep.
Wow.
So 1 day can kill you without moisture.
So what do we do then if we're lost and we need to find some water?
Well, one of the ways of doing it is you happen to find plastic bags. You know, the world is pretty littered at the moment, so you can find garbage around. If you wrap a plastic bag around a bunch of leaves on a tree and the sun hits it, you'll get a little bit of moisture off those leaves. But you do need to sort of do that to a lot of leaves and do it regularly and check it. Another way I really like is you can wrap your T-shirt or jump around your legs and first thing in the morning sort of run through the grass and everything. And especially in the desert, you get dew if you have a clear sky.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, so you can get the dew on the T-shirt and then you can get a little bit of moisture from that.
But what about this?
I always carry a water filter. So this is probably...
You always carry one of these?
Yeah.
Really?
Especially in Australia, because you never know. Like
even in the car?
No, sorry, I mean when I'm out in the bush.
Oh, okay.
When I'm going out on a hike. But you can carry one of these in the car with you if you like. This is sort of a more portable version of this water filter.
Yep.
And, I mean, I've pumped water out of a billabong with a dead kangaroo in it using this and I've not got sick. So it gets about 99.9% of everything out of the water that can make you sick. So I just got a little demonstration. Let's see if this will work.
Yep.
So food dye is pretty much almost the same as water in its consistency. And this water filter should take out most of the food dye on the other side.
Oh, wow.
That's amazing.
That is incredible.
And so this is not so portable for everyone, but every time I'm back, like even just a day hike, I'll take one of these out. You know that mother that got lost just going on a day hike?
Yes.
You know, with this you can drink over 120 litres of water out of puddles and everything and you're not going to make yourself sick. So
that's amazing. Really,
can I just ask one more quick question? Because I know we've run out of time, but Bear Grylls often drinks his own wee when he gets...
Never drink your own wee.
Oh, but what if you've got this though?
Right, you could with that, but the problem with drinking your own pee is only do it when you're really, really in a dire situation, because what it is, it's your waste product.
Okay.
So your kidneys are already filtering that out, and as you start to drink more and more, the kidneys are working harder and your kidneys can shut down very quickly drinking your own pee. So it shouldn't be your go-to.
It's something I don't often do.
No, I don't recommend it.
Hey, Bear Grylls does it, so I just thought I'd check. Now, if you would like to see Ky in action talking about her amazing skills, you can catch her in Brisbane next week at the Powerhouse Talk. For more information, you can head to girlshapedflames.com. Ky Furneaux, it's always lovely seeing you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for
amazing. Trying, mate.